Hey, sorry.
What are you going to do?
Well, I was going to go there.
No, here, stay there because you've got the picture.
Probably
better for them.
Sorry?
Probably better for them to be there. I'm going that side.
Sorry.
You bought me a model
chair. I'm hoping things are going to get a bit better.
Yeah, I suppose you've got to find that element of
positivity,
don't you?
Excellent.
All right,
well, I'll let you do your thing.
Okay. Sorry.
Right. Okay. Need a chair, right?
No, it's okay. Oh, Paula, so what's happening today?
I'm going to start in about 5 minutes, which is one or two more things that will arrive.
Right. It's the 1 year on. This?
Yep.
The InclusionLondon, 1 year on, evaluating the independent living fund closure report. So everyone who used to be disabled people who used to be in the ILF, who've been reassessed for social care, with their local social services, the impact of the closure and the cuts to their social care packages, basically. And this is the formal launch of the report in Parliament today.
Okay, that's good. So we'll learn a few things. So please tweet this out and send this off. Facebook,
yeah.
Google+, anything.
Write to IL, write to Inclusion, Independent Living.
Yeah, you'll also see the, on the title itself, you'll see the Twitter account for DPAC. This, DIS _PPL_protest. It's a bit long, but you know, this is the early days of Twitter, so they didn't know better. But in any case, we should be starting soon. And what else is there to say? Well, if you, whichever area you're in, perhaps you might be able to contact your MPs and tell them about, you know, that the ILF is needed. Unfortunately, if you live in a conservative area, it might still work, because they do have to pay lip service by caring for the community, but then what, you know, their Tories, I have no idea.
I'm not sure how to do it.
I'm not sure what to do with the. There's going to be interpreters. So do I focus on the interpreters or the speaking listeners?
Interesting comment. You know, do well. That's one of
them.
Yeah, we had it too.
I'm just checking the data.
Yeah.
Fine.
Yeah, definitely.
No, I think they're the races on the plan of us.
It feels like plastic.
Hmm.
just one of the speakers, isn't it? Fantastic. Yeah.
Okay, I think we're ready to start. Thank you, and welcome to the launch of One Year On, the closure of the ILF and the future of the Independent Living Fund for Disabled People, a report funded and published by InclusionLondon. But firstly, let me say this. The closure of the ILF was a cut. The government denied this, but it was. You know it, I know it, and they know it. Now, the Independent Living Fund wasn't perfect, but enabled people with the highest support needs to live independently within the community rather than being shut away in institutions. And its closure, this cut, was not a single cut in isolation, but it came on the back of cuts to the Access to Work employment programme, cuts to the grant funding for disabled students, and don't get me started on the bedroom tax and the myriad of benefit sanctions. It's part of a targeted onslaught. However, it was the closure of the Independent Living Fund that was the cruelest cut of all. It sent a clear message to disabled people and an equally clear message to society that we are a burden and that we're an unacceptable expense.
Sure.
I was born in the 60s when disabled people were seldom seen or heard, and a lot's changed since then. Although far from perfect, there's better representation of disabled people in the media. There's been civil rights legislation, disabled people in the House of Commons and in the House of Lords. That's brilliant. But this cut, the closure of the Independent Living Fund, puts all that progress in jeopardy. For those disabled people with high support needs, the effects are already being felt. As this report highlights, we hear about people having their support slashed in half, having their nighttime care removed, having their staff hourly rates cut. Looking to the future, unless there is a change of policy or direction, it's going to result in more and more disabled people becoming prisoners in our own homes or forced into residential care. The current problems have been created by the government. Firstly, by closing the ILF, and secondly, by not ring-fencing the money when responsibility was transferred to local authorities. In England, we look friendly to Scotland, to Wales, to Northern Ireland, because the funds there have been protected by their respective assemblies, but not in England. Our politicians, with a few notable exceptions, have washed their hands of us. But I digress. We're here to launch a report, and we've got an array of speakers. Some who have fought to save the ILF, some who are living with the consequences, and a few lawyers and politicians thrown in just for good measure. So, firstly, I'd like to introduce Ellen to say a few words.
Thank you, Brian, and thank you everyone for coming. To start with, I'm just going to say a few brief words about the report itself that we're bringing out today. I'm going to try and keep it brief because I think the most powerful, important thing today is to hear from the people who are directly affected and to hear your lived experiences. What we tried to do with this report is to present a kind of evidence base for evaluating the impact of the closure. We know, because we've been in contact with ILF recipients through the campaign, how it's hurt individuals, and there's a lot of terrible, heartbreaking examples in the report. With the report, we have focused on London, because we're Inclusion London, and what we've done is we submitted Freedom of Information requests to all 33 London boroughs, and all of them replied. Hackney were a bit slow, but we did get all 33 back, And we also sent out some surveys to deaf and disabled people's organisations in London to hear about their experiences and the experiences of their members. And as you can imagine, those experiences have overwhelmingly been negative, ranging from individuals who are waiting for assessment, who are filled with anxiety, who are going through intrusive assessment processes, to people who've actually been told that they're having substantial amounts of support cut and that their lives are going to be impacted as a result. They're not going to be able to go out to choose when to eat, when to drink, when to go to the toilet. Focusing on London, I do have a question actually about how representative London is of the picture across the whole of England. Certainly themes that have emerged through this report, such as the dramatic postcode lottery, the differences between boroughs, that is representative of what seems to be the national picture. However, I do think that the Save ILF campaign is particularly active in London. And speaking to Channel 4, they've just done some national FOIs, they're going to make them public in a couple of weeks. And they say, looking at those, they seem to show that around 85% of local authorities have made some sort of cut since the closure. Whereas in London, we've got about a third of London boroughs haven't made any cuts yet. So it looks like it's slightly better in London. And I do wonder how much that's to do with how active the campaigning has been that many of you here were involved in. The main thing the report really tells us, apart from the terrible experiences of people going through the closure, is what a postcode lottery it is. So we've had some boroughs like Hammersmith and Fulham who've made a political commitment to retaining the ILF level support packages. So this is from Councillor Vivian Lukey, who says, as a council, Hammersmith and Fulham is serious about protecting and enhancing the well-being of its residents. Through our decision to step in and protect the Independent Living Fund after its closure by central government, we have secured ongoing support for disabled people in the borough. We were able to do this by making a wide range of savings and cutting wasteful expenditure, including cutting the number of senior managers, cutting the costs of office space we use, scrapping council magazines, and reducing the PR budget. Through the decisions we've taken, we've been able to support our residents, including enabling disabled people to keep the life-changing funding they deserve. So Hammersmith and Fulham really shows that making cuts as a consequence of the closure of the ILF is by no means inevitable. They made a political decision to protect those funds, and they actually found funding to do that, to cover the costs. That was before the government announced that there would be 4 years of the former ILF recipients fund. Other boroughs, though, have where they have protected packages, it's very clearly tied to that funding coming from central government. So Westminster, another borough that haven't made any cuts, they said the ILF customers funding was passed to the council, and this enabled us to protect packages by using the support money from central government. Support packages have therefore remained as they were. So I think in the majority of cases where there haven't been cases, that's been totally dependent upon the funding from central government. The implication of that is take away the designated funding from central government, and those boroughs will be cutting like others. And some boroughs have gone through systematically making cuts. For example, boroughs that come out particularly badly are Waltham Forest and Hounslow. And they seem to have taken the approach that they have absolutely no responsibility for meeting the support needs that were once covered by the ALF. Another inconsistency that emerges through the report is just in terms of practice. So one thing the report picks up on is around referrals for community healthcare funding. And what I found particularly interesting was that whereas some boroughs seem to be are operating a system where they will test for eligibility before they pass people on, because the CHC assessment is quite lengthy and intrusive, some boroughs seem to have just referred everybody and have been wasting a lot of time and resources and making people go through unnecessary assessment processes. So that really highlights that sharing practice and consistency between local authorities might be an idea. The government's currently consulting on the former ILF recipient grant from the central government, and they're suggesting that is one of the things that's taken over by local authorities after 2020 through what they're calling self-sufficient local government through the retention of business rates. And we think that would be disastrous. That would mean that the ending of that central funding would mean there would be cuts, as we've seen in other boroughs that haven't taken on responsibility.
Oh, that's okay.
the website. Hi guys, okay, yeah, you can actually access the you can access the report in the Inclusion London website. Thank you.
The transition experiences of former ILF recipients have also really shone a light on what's been happening in terms of the implementation of the Care Act and how well or not that is happening in local authority areas. And we've got some solicitors who've been incredibly supportive from Scott Moncrieff who are going to talk just a bit about that later. What we've been seeing then through the experiences of the former ILF recipients is the wider failings and difficulties within an underfunded and overstretched mainstream care and support system. And the conclusion that we seem to have come to with this report is that actually what we need is a national system of social care that is independent of local authorities, where decisions to fund disabled people's support is based on need and not being subject to overriding political concerns. Independent living for disabled people is going backwards in this country, and as a result of the limitations of our current social care support system. If we want a society where disabled people have dignity and the same life chances as everyone else, then it seems to be that we need some major changes to our social care system. And what we need is for disabled people and independent living support users to be central to developing those ideas about how we go forward and how we have a society that's there for all. Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you, Ellen. I'd now like to hand over to Sherilyn Houston, who's an actor and independent living campaigner.
Hello, everybody. Please bear with me if I get a bit upset because I'm slightly heartbroken. I've been talking to my peers downstairs, and I started to learn the reality, which I was aware of, but the reality of the horror of many of our lives is just abhorrent. When I first became disabled, which was over 20 years ago, I researched into my history and I was so excited to hear of the campaigning we'd done of Paul Hunt, who in the 70s wrote to The Guardian and said, I'm living in a care home. I don't want to live in a care home. I want to live out amongst everybody else. I want the same life as anybody else. Just, you know, is there anybody else like me? And then it took until the 1980s where John Evans, he was a guy who had able-bodied guy who had a car accident and he then had high support needs. He lived with his friends in a cottage for a year because his mates and his family didn't want him to go into care. So, but they couldn't cope supporting his needs, so he went into care and he fought and he made his friends in the care home fight, and it took him 3 years and he got out to live independently. And that man set the precedent. And all these people here today, we have been campaigning and campaigning for our rights. And then suddenly, last year, those rights to independence and freedom were taken away from us. So what justice? Before the ILF, there was this story of this lady who, she was in a bed and she had 5 cups of water lined up on her bedside table. It wasn't because she was thirsty, it was because that's how thirsty she would be until somebody returned to refill those cups. After the ILF, that woman got hydrotherapy. Her care staff took her to hydrotherapy. She got stronger. She got strong enough to then volunteer. Through the volunteer work, she then got a paid job. You are taking us back to where we are just fighting for our basic rights. Local authority care does not work. You cut them by 33%. How on earth, if you've not ring-fenced the ILF money? Yes, for some boroughs, brilliant, and some councils, but there's many that haven't ring-fenced that money. In Manchester, there is no care. If you have high support needs, there is no care to help you, no money to pay to help you wash your clothes, to clean your house, to go and do your food shopping. You have no right to go outside your home. I'm so upset. I was talking to somebody from Manchester today who used to have 64 hours care. She had a full life. She was then cut to 34, which was then cut to 12. Now, under that care, you have to pay for the holiday pay of your carers. You have to pay for the insurance. So that works out 7 hours a week for somebody who needed 64 hours a week care. Now that is half an hour to get up in the morning and half an hour to go to bed. Nobody will come out to work half an hour for you. Yeah. Local authorities are deciding what time you go to bed. Please, MPs in this room, think. Think about the colour and the detail of your life. Think about the adventures you have, the dates you go on, the meals you decide to go to, the things that make you interesting, the things, your hobbies, your friends, your families, all that detail of your life. And then think, okay, I've just handed that over to the local authorities who are saying that you will go to bed at this time every day. You will get up at this time every day. Human beings decide, if you have a nice night, you might want to stay up a bit longer. That's not relevant anymore. It's just appalling. If you can put a fork in a ready meal, we don't get help with making food anymore. And if we can't, the only help we're being offered is ready meals. It's just abhorrent. You just need to think who you are, how you think, who you love. We all feel the same as you. We all are the same human beings. We have the same instincts. All it is that our bodies don't live up to what our brains want. But with the ILF, that enabled us to participate in society. And that has been removed. People are now back to fighting for their basic human rights. Our disabled children will never live independently. Disabled children with high support needs at schools now, alive now, will never have the opportunity to live independently. There's no words to say that. Where's their rights? People have been told, I mean, some of the things I'm going to tell you is just so astounding. People have been told there's enough within these four walls to sustain your needs. You don't need to go outside. Prisoners are allowed to go outside. We are being offered incontinence pads when we are not incontinent. Mm. Just think about if somebody gave you incontinence pads and said, you sit there and you wait and you will get desperate. You will get really desperate before you go to the loo. And you're going to have to think, well, my next care time's not going to be probably for 3 or 4 hours. Can I hold on? How long do I want to sit in my own waste? It'll go cold. Think about that reality. Is that how we should allow a percentage of our society to live these days? Because there are no obvious prisons. There are no bars. There are nothing blocking us in. But how do we live independently with no helping hands, no carers to help dress us, to help us face the world? Our prisons from outside just look like your homes. So there's been no outcry. For some reason, most of the people I talk to in this country don't know that this is what has happened to us. There's no real understanding of what has been done to disabled people, and we have to turn it back. I mean, I think it sounds stupid, but like me and my job, you can make a difference. You know, people all over the country, lawyers, you know, doing all different jobs as disabled people. But if you stifle the fact that we can't even get out of our homes, how the hell are we going to contribute to society? If you took away, say, a few people out of this room, and we were all sort of solving a puzzle or having a chat, we would be less... It wouldn't be as a useful discussion if you took those people away. And what you're doing is you're taking people out of society who have the right, as everybody else, to live a colourful life and live to our full potential. Please, please, do not make it so we're just sat there, lined up with glasses of water. We have to make a change. We have to keep fighting until we get this back. Thank you.
Thank you, Sarah Lee. I think next we have Jonathan Bartley. Now, I think congratulations might be in order. I believe, is this your first official appearance as co-leader of the Green Party?
That's great. I didn't expect to be in tears. I when I first met Caroline Lucas, so I'm co-leader of the Green Party, was at a demo just over a year ago against closure of the independent fund. My roots into politics is very much shaped by my son, who's now 14 years old, he's a wheelchair user. And I know the personal experience, you know, for battling for everything, battling for to get into a local school, battling your local authority, when you think your social worker should be your ally, having to fight your social worker if they try to make cuts to your direct payments and try to palm you off with the continuing care budget. The fight that I'm involved in at the moment. Greens, I joined the Green Party because of my son. After a confrontation with David Cameron in 2010, I took a long, hard look at the manifestos and I said, look, there's only one party here. I believe it's really standing up for disabled people and I've got to go, I've got to join it. And we're doing the job share with Caroline Lucas, MP, because I can't be a 24/7 politician. I have responsibilities to my son and to my family. And I take those responsibilities very seriously, and being in politics demands 24/7. So I approached Caroline and said, you know, would you do this job share? We talked about it and we saw that we had common values, and we also, thank you. That's really kind, thank you. We saw that we had these common values and what was important. But it's also, when we made our leadership speech on Friday, we talked about putting people back in control. There was a theme in the EU referendum on taking back control. It wasn't just about the EU referendum. There was a feeling of real anger in this country, of abandonment by many, many people, and they directed it at Westminster. And then you, for the first time in that referendum, every vote would count, and boy, did they make that vote count, and they shouted. And I noticed one of the things in this report is that so many people with disabilities feel they have no longer had that control. They are scared about what is going to happen. They won't speak up against their local authority because they're frightened of being penalised by the local authority. The local authority that is supposed to stick up and defend their rights. That is a terrible place to be in the country. And I see the cuts being pushed through ideologically by a government that doesn't get inclusion, has decided that the best way to push it through is to divide communities. So the able-bodied, the non-disabled are divided against the disabled, and they let fight it out because they won't take responsibility for what they're doing. And we've got to fight back, friends. And I'm happy to say that the Green Party will support every recommendation in this report. I'm going to continue to fight for it. We'll continue to fight for a new fund, a new system, which actually meets people where they're at, determined and shaped by the people that it affects, putting disabled people back in control, driven by need, driven by the needs and calls of disabled people, and that's what the disabled rights movement was built upon, and that's the way it should be. And hearing you talk about disabled children in the future, I look at my 14-year-old son and I see his future, and it scares me. I don't know how you feel when you feel like your support can be taken away and you're going to be left in a prisoner in your own home, because I fear that's what's going to happen to my son too. I think this report is outstanding, and particularly outstanding in that it's not just a figure of 16,500 people who relied on the Independent Living Fund, which would be a statistic on a government spreadsheet. This tells the stories. This tells about humanity that these aren't statistics, these aren't numbers to be shunted around. These aren't people just to be pushed to one side. These are real lives, real stories, real families, real children. And I think if we're gonna win this fight, this is the way we're going to do it. Have to be front and centre, and it's no wonder that some people here stormed the chamber of the House of Commons. Yeah. And I'm proud that my colleague Caroline Lucas stood up and stood with those people who did that, because it's just not acceptable for a government to do what it's doing, and people need to be angry about it. And however undignified it might seem to some people, it's nothing compared to the indignity that people are undergoing as a result of the cut to the Independent Living Fund. So friends, I'm just here to pledge our support. It's something I want to make a priority. I will say that I want to work with other parties too. I'll say that openly, and I will challenge Labour here. Labour control a lot of these councils that aren't ring-fencing this money. And I would like to see the Labour leadership say unequivocally to their councils that this money needs to be ring-fenced. They have the power to do it. And we will support you and we will vote with you in that, and the Lib Dems too, because we need to fight together. This is no time to be divided. We need to come together, and if you know, we talk about having more in common, then we need to show it in our actions. Anyway, folks, I'll leave it there, because there are more important voices to hear today. But thank you very much.
Thank you, Jonathan. Adam, I think I had five nicked before, but I think you might
have...
I'd like to ask Sean McGovern, former ILF recipient, and TUC General Member Council.
Thanks, everyone. So I'm Sean McGovern. I'm a disabled trade union activist, campaigner, and person. So far, I've been speaking a bit. I'm feeling a little bit inadequate here. So what I'm going to do is cheat a bit. I wrote a little thing last year in around this, just for the hell of it, because I felt it's easier to express myself. So it's called ILF. A PA is to help me bathe, toilet, and dress. But there's more to living than just personal care. To have access to work, I hold down a job, earn some corn, and pay my way. Thus, social care maintains the body, and access to work supports me in my job. But what of life itself, of social interaction? Without support, how do I exercise my soul? ILF bridges the empty shutdown of social exclusion and the sunshine of independence. So give me bread to feed my body, allow me roses to satisfy my soul. I really do believe this is a bread and roses situation, and barely actually getting bread now because of the way they're cutting back on things like cooking. Yeah, I'm an ex-ILF recipient. I work in the industry as well. I'm actually a direct payment advisor as well, a local authority. And I'm in the middle of almost litigious situation with them. I was meant to have a review, back in the beginning of August. And the evening before my review, 4:30, I get an email from my social worker saying, looking forward to meeting you tomorrow for your reassessment. So straight away, my hackles are up. I then waited until the following morning. I couldn't phone her up that evening, otherwise I would. Following morning, got into work, picked up the phone, spoke to her. She then said, there's no difference between a review and an assessment. Now, sadly, this is what's happening with the encounters. Now, I'm not sure if she was a social worker or an assessor, to be honest. Once upon a time, social workers were there, supposedly, to give us assessment, independent assessment, objective assessments of our needs. Not to look, first of all, at the local authority, but online, and see what they can afford, which is increasingly what they're doing. I've got quite a few ex-ILF recipients as my clients at the moment, and I'm seeing what they're doing to their budgets. And I've told my social worker outright, you're coming to my place, they've set up a team in Lambeth where I live, and I call it, it's the hatchet team, basically. They're set up there to come in, and they want to just cut, particularly ILF, they're cutting everyone's budgets, by the way, but the support budgets for ILF users are particularly going for them. They see lots of meat on the bone situation. They want to pair that right away back to the bone itself. And I've argued this with them. I've not heard back from them for a month. But what I asked for was actually at the time I said, I want my assessment, the face assessment form to be sent through to me. Because I have the right to ask the questions if it's an assessment. So I have to see what questions you're asking me. I looked through the form and I'm penultimate from page 17 on the question of eligibility. It actually printed in there, this client has no assessment. And for needs. So straight away almost, it predetermined the thing without even meeting me. I actually believe it's stuck up rather than a conspiracy. They're not actually that stupid, although they are quite stupid. So there was a situation, like everyone said, look, it's not as though we're asking for something. We're not asking for holidays in the Bahamas. We're not asking for another Philip Green style yacht. We're not asking for a duck house in a moat. We're not asking for anything. We are asking for what is the most basic, not even human rights, just the things that we need to live day to day. So we don't want to be sitting in our mess for hours on end. We don't want to be eating meals prepared in some factory miles away. It's barely digestible. We do want to be able to go out shopping to buy the things we need. And I'm not talking about going to Bond Street or Oxford Street. I'm talking about going to that Brixton Market so I can see the vegetables I buy, probably in the Sainsbury's, things like this. I use my washing machine 7 times a week at least. They walk around and say, got 45 minutes. The programme takes an hour plus. Sure, my PAs are working between times to do other things. They don't stand there watching the machine rattle on. The thing is, there was this saying that there's no room for domestic. Now, I'm in a situation where I'm quite vulnerable to picking up infections. So I do need my house tidy and clean. They're not interested. It seems to be all about unmet needs, and increasingly, sadly, they're using the Care Act on that, because the Care Act has a provision in there. On the one hand, you've got this dilemma. On the one hand, you've got well-being, they're supposed to look at your well-being, and on the other hand, then they're saying, well, actually, they put that down as an unmet need, and you don't get it. You just don't get the need. The TEC and Unite, amongst other unions, are working closely around the island. We believe it's something, again, not a right. This is something we didn't know, just to live on par with most of the rest of society is all we're asking. We will become prisoners in our own homes. I may be lucky that I'll go to work 3 days a week because I'm getting access to work, but once I get behind that front door again, I'll be in the same position. I'm not in a position to go out because I actually need someone to go out for, help me with toilets and things like that. Okay, and this other thing is the bearing your soul side of it. Now, whenever you have an assessment like that, you take your dignity, you throw that out the window, you put that in the cupboard for the time being, and you have to bear your soul. You know, they're asking questions, and they're saying, I've got a PDF form. And they're saying, well, just fill the PDF form. Print it up and put it. I said, but you're giving me one line to explain a very, very complex care need. It's going to take me a page and 2 pages. So the whole thing is set up against the service user. So at the moment, I'm still waiting for an accessible form. I want the faith form, assessment form, accessible. That was a month ago. Still haven't heard from them. I've spoken to my local councillor, who happens to be the cabinet councillor for adult services in the borough, and I've said I believe that the social workers have predetermined my situation. Mm-hmm. Maybe that's why I've not heard from them. I will certainly be bringing my council to court on this. Mm-hmm. So at the moment we're fighting this, I pass some people on to Inclusion London. Maybe I'm hoping the $300 budget will hold up to it. But we are really in a situation where the money's there. You can almost understand it maybe if they say that we haven't got the money. Yes, you have. And a lot of them are saying they're using the money side. It's all about the money. A lot of people in my borough, ILF, don't realise that the fund has been extended for 4 years. They don't realise that. So the money is actually there. So again, they're using all sorts of ploys to take people's services away, to cut the services back, and it's not a bright future. The one beacon of light, I think, is meetings like this. They're not going to let it go away. The DPAC, that triangle organisation, are not going to let this go away. TUC, Unite, and other unions are not going to sit back and allow this government. And sadly, before the last election, I was speaking to people within the shadow cabinet and was saying that they don't agree with ILF. That they almost tantamount to saying we agree with scrapping it. We were arguing, before you even think of scrapping it, we need something put in its place. They were arguing that it's a postcode lottery, only 17,000 people receiving it, therefore it's unfair on the rest of the same group. Absolutely agree. It's unfair for those other scores of thousands, hundreds of thousands of people who aren't in receipt of it, but that doesn't mean you take it away from those who have it. It's the lowest common denominator form of politics. I think one of them is maybe here today, that didn't actually understand when I spoke to them why millions and millions of people were supporting ILF users when only 17,000 received it. And I had to remind them, actually it's called solidarity, which is one of the basic building blocks of socialism. And that's really sad when Labour MPs have forgotten their socialist foundations and roots. I'll leave it there, thanks.
Thank you. Thanks, Sean. I'd like to invite Kevin Caulfield next from Hamilton.
Hammersmith and Fulham Coalition Games Clubs, is that right? And a former ILF recipient.
Hi there, my name's Kevin Caulfield. I don't know if everyone can hear me at the back, because
yes.
I'm not a radio campaigner. But, I'm from a local organisation, a local campaigning group called Hammersmith and Fulham Coalition Against Cuts. And that's going to be really important in terms of what I want to say today, in terms of the campaigning and the successes that we've had locally in Hammersmith and Fulham. And I've also been an ILFer since the early 90s. I wanted to start today by going back to something I said in 2012, which was that the announcement of the closure of the ILF is just another nail in the coffin of the increasing numbers of disabled people being discarded into isolation, social exclusion, deteriorating health, and premature death. And this is more evidence that we are so far away from being all in this together. And anecdotally and illustrated really strongly in the report is that what I said then is true. And we knew really what was coming. The loss of the ILF is a huge loss, as the report explains, in that the fund was striking, despite its shortcomings, in terms of the money improving disabled people's access to privacy and a family life and to the opportunities for wider participation in society. The ILF money gave us more control over the support that we needed, who provided that support, and meant that our human and civil rights were better protected and promoted. So it is a huge loss. On a personal level for me, since the early 90s, that's 20 years ago, it's enabled me, the ILF money and the funding from Hammersmith and Fulham Council, has enabled me to have a pretty good quality of life. It's helped me stabilise my health. It's kept me away from unsafe institutions, reduced the amount of hospital admissions that I would have had. It's enabled me to have control over what I do day to day, working, college, volunteering, maintaining relationships, campaigning, friends, family, with a good level of spontaneity that I just would never have had. So for me, like everybody else, the biggest fears on the closure, or just as this report illustrates, that the money wouldn't be ring-fenced. The reassessments would attempt to cut the amount of money available and support, and that any reality for me and all of us who believe in independent living would be ditched in favour of the lowest common denominator, bed and breakfast, basic levels of support that often is provided under the misnamed concept of personalisation and the inadequacies that surround the Care Act. There is no personalisation without financial resources and a commitment to independent living. What the Independent Living Fund did to some extent was protect us from the whims of local authority policy and postcode lotteries. Again, the report illustrates that point. And the ILF resource decision-making process was mostly based on meeting our needs and not on local authority funding, resource allocation systems concocted deliberately to be non-transparent and just process-driven. Disabled people have always known that our independent living, our rights to equality, inclusion, and human rights would generally not be safe with local authorities. And just outrightly abandoned, as we have seen since the destructive social cleansing policies viciously implemented since 2010, and the seeds for that onslaught was planted before 2010. So I'm just going to talk a little bit about our local campaigning. So HAVCAC, which is our acronym, was formed in 2006 to challenge the local cuts to disabled people that were taking place because we had a new, very right-wing conservative council. It was Cameron's flagship council, Hammersmith and Fulham. And a lot of the policies of the Common Zone government were predicated on what was happening in Hammersmith and Fulham. So those policies were targeting generally the poorest and most disadvantaged residents of Hammersmith and Fulham. So we formed an independent campaign group, not funded by our local authority, not funded by anybody, so that we could just campaign and tell it like it is for disabled people without fear or favour. No one can take money off you if you don't have any, and they don't give you any. And so what I said before about worrying, those fears that we've all had and that other people have illustrated really poignantly today, have not been realised in Hammersmith and Fulham. So the background to Hammersmith and Fulham Council statement that Ellen read out at the beginning is that some disabled people, along with HAVCAC, had vociferously and emergently campaigned against charging local disabled people for home care services, or independent living support, as we would call it, since 2006. And it was a result of that strong campaigning by a small group of local disabled people that we eventually found a real willingness from the Labour opposition group at the time to learn about the impact of policy on disabled people's lives, and really, surprisingly, and sometimes we have to pinch ourselves and wake up that we live in a borough where people are actually listening, politicians are actually listening, that with the local elections in 2014, we elected a new Labour administration who had not only made promises in their manifesto to abolish children, but then went ahead and delivered on them. The leader of Hammersmith and Fulham Council says, as long as I'm leader of this council, no disabled person is going to be charged for home care services. And that's a really strong statement from a leader of a local council. So with the closure of the ILF, the same council leader, who really understood the day-to-day impact of what that money did. He visited ILF users in their homes. He'd really understood what the money meant and what the money brought about on a day-to-day basis. And quickly after that, he announced that the transferred money would be ring-fenced, categorically would be ring-fenced. It wouldn't be used for anything else. And also that he also made a commitment that support packages, all of those support packages, would be funded until 2018, which is the next local elections, and that they would be funded regardless of whether the government transferred money or didn't transfer the money. So a really unbelievably huge commitment from our council, and I think the only council in the country to do that. And pragmatically, if you people using the ILF had worked with the council cabinet member for adult social care and relevant council officers in a real spirit of co-production to try and ensure that the transition went as smoothly as possible. And so far, it has gone really smoothly. And so it's proof that austerity is not the only way. And I think what Jonathan said was quite important today, that we need as well Labour leaders to if the leader of Hammersmith and Fulham Council can do this, then so can the Labour leaders, all Labour-led councils. So kind of in conclusion, the main problem is not disabled people's support costing too much money. It's social. Socioeconomic inequality fueled by the government and local policy. The political decision to close the fund has only led to greater poverty of life and increased exclusion by some disabled people. Some politicians and elements of the press are locked in a cycle of persistent anti-disabled people rhetoric that they present as what people really think. They've been instrumental in the creation of the narrative of disabled people's challenges, providing the backdrop for the cuts. And with the Paralympics being used every 4 years to assist in the smokescreen of what is really happening.
Yeah.
But it doesn't have to be like that. Our local experience is that strong campaigning, local disabled people's organisations can make a significant impact on policy. And Hammersmith and Fulham show that austerity does not have to be the only way, and that it is an ideological policy constructed by those who are not affected by austerity against those who are. I remember when we, about 10 years ago, when we were campaigning, when we had charging, we in the council meeting, we were told by the then leader of the council, you need to wake up and live in the real world, because you will never live in this borough where, and there will never be a situation in this borough where disabled people are not charged for services. Well, we do. And although we still have a lot to do, we're now setting up a new Disabled People's Commission in the borough to tackle some of the charging and the ILF budget. They're two huge issues. But as we know, disabled people face loads of a myriad of issues that we really want to face. So I today's really important, and to acknowledge really all the work that's been done around the Save the ILF campaign. And although sometimes there's disagreement on how our support is funded and structured and provided, what the campaign has done really is kept the principle and issues around independent living that are so important alive, and that's really important.
Thanks, Kevin. Now I hand over to Mark Harrison from Equalize. Thank you.
Thank you. Equalize is a disabled people's organisation that does what Kevin talked about. We campaign and fight for independent living and equality. We also run services that support disabled people to live independent lives. And we are in that tradition of the coalition, so we were Norfolk Coalition of Disabled People. And we're very proud to be here today as part of this event, and also we're proud that we're members of DPAC. We think that all disabled people's organisations around the country should fight for independent living, fight for the principles that DPAC stand for. I want to talk about our challenge to the government, to the Department of Health and the Care Quality Commission, who are supposed to inspect social care, and just draw some lessons from it, because in Norfolk what we were finding was that disabled people were having their reviews or reassessments or assessments, and they were having their budgets either slashed by 50-60%, or they were losing their budgets altogether. So you've got people who have been eligible for services for 10, 15, 20 years, who are suddenly told they're no longer eligible for social care. And I suppose one of the things that was really important was one of our advocates who actually bothered to read the Care Act. And what she came back and said was that this is completely illegal. In the guidance, they're not allowed to do that, but nobody was holding them to account. So we started a campaign. We first of all talked to the council, but we got nowhere. I mean, they were just they were instructing their social workers to say that we live in austere times, everybody has to have their budgets cut. Again, that is completely illegal. So we So we decided that as this avalanche of increase in disabled people's misery, if you like, came on us, we couldn't just sit down and do nothing. And it was completely driven by austerity. Since 2010, all boroughs have received a cut of about 40% in their funding. And that's at a time where the need and the demand for adult social care is rising. So it's a huge cut. Our council over the next 2 years faces another £20 million worth of cuts just in adult social care. So you can see, and nationally, I think it was the King's Fund recently calculated that to fund adult social care effectively across the country, another £1 billion is needed. £1 billion isn't very much money if you're Philip Green and other tax avoiders or Apple or Google or... But it, so it's not, in the scale of things, a huge amount of money. But we're facing, based on the current government's projections, another £20 million cut in adult social care. Now, we know that they're not meeting their legal duties, their statutory duties now. To take another £20 million out of a local authority adult social care department over the next 2 years is going to destroy what's left. And we live in extreme times. In Norfolk, we've got a complete crisis in all our health and social care, which is collapsed. Our two major hospitals in the county are in special measures. Our mental health trust is in special measures. Our children's services are in special measures. And adult social care would be in special measures if there was an inspection regime to put them in there. But surprise, surprise, these bodies, these local authority adult social care departments that spend billions of pounds a year up and down the country purchasing adult social care, there's no inspection regime. It was got rid of before the Care Act, and it's enshrined in the Care Act. So there's no provision. What there is provision for, and what we found from reading the Act and reading the guidance, is that if you can prove the systemic failure in a local authority, then you can ask the Secretary of State to order a CQC inspection. So that's what we did. And it's on our website, on our campaign page, and it's a lovely letter to Mr. Jeremy Hunt. And I recommend you go and read it. Because it, what we've done is we've taken the lived experience of disabled people and we've put it against the provision of the duties in the Care Act and spelt it out. What was interesting was that all sorts of funny things started to happen as soon as we made a complaint nationally and asked the DOH to order an inspection. And they did everything they could to avoid an inspection. So the Department of Health, I phoned them up and said, I sent you a letter. Can you tell me when you're going to make a decision? They said, it's not our decision, it's the CQC decision. So I said, that's not what it says in the legislation. I phoned the CQC and said, the Department of Health tell us that we've asked you to investigate, but ask them to investigate, but it's your decision. And CQC said to us, it's not our decision, it's the Department of Health. So there was these frantic activity and negotiations, all these smoke and mirrors. Nobody was talking to us. No. And one of the CQC inspectors was going to come up. He took the evidence and he said, I'm going to interview. So I said, well, I'll put you in touch with all our service users. I'll set up a meeting for you. You can meet our advocates who will tell you as it is. And 2 days before the meeting happened, he cancelled the meeting. I'm not coming to Norfolk. I don't need to come. We don't need that. We've got enough information, thank you. And then, of course, we got the letter from Alistair Burt, who was the Minister of Social Care at the time. And Sir Humphrey would have been proud of the letter. But the deal that they did was that rather than having a proper inspection, they went to the local government association and got money to fund the Social Care Institute for Excellence to do a review of their adult social care provision. Now, this was interesting because As the Social Care Institute for Excellence, it used to be funded by our government, but now doesn't get very much government grant. It relies on commissions from local authorities for their survival. And, of course, then they become a gun for hire. And who are their customers? The local authorities, who they're going on in to do reports on. So I'll leave you to draw your own conclusions there. And I suppose it didn't bode very well when the person that came up to do the inspection at the beginning of the review process said to us, virtually, I'm a social worker, trust me. But that review was only restricted to best practice under the Care Act. So, and that's been and gone, and it's not helpful to anybody because it doesn't make any comment on resources, on policy. And we had a Rainbow Coalition local authority led by Labour, with the Greens and the Lib Dems, with UKIP in the background. Norfolk's a funny place, I tell you. So it was a Labour-led local authority that was imposing the cuts. And our leader of adult social care, in contrast to the experience of Kevin in Hammersmith in Fulham, went on local TV and said, we're not here to pay for disabled people's social lives. That was her point. So I'll leave you to draw your own conclusions there. The findings of the Sky report have been challenged by lawyers. If you look at Belinda Schwer's, if you go on the community care website, there's a really good piece by Belinda Schwer, which spells out where the Sky review is ignoring the actual legal position in the Care Act. And the Sky review is completely inadequate because it completely ignores the fact that with the available resources that Norfolk County Council have, based on the austerity cuts and the situation I've talked about, have got not a hope in hell. They could never actually meet their legal duties. And it's not just Norfolk. I don't believe that any local authority, maybe apart from Hammersmith and Fulham, is meeting its legal duties under the Care Act. Mm-hmm. There's not one in the country. So it's no wonder the Minister of State didn't want a review. The last thing they wanted was the CQC doing a proper inspection. Because if one local authority isn't compliant, then they're all not compliant. I have to say that we came, a whole number of us were in over the way at Portcullis House on the International Day of Disabled People, December the 3rd, last year. And Owen Smith was in the room. And we raised this with him and the Minister, Shadow Minister for Disabled People. And he was very clear that they weren't going to rock the boat, that actually, I think his words around welfare reform was, it's popular with the public, therefore we're not going to change it. And when he was challenged, on him. But when he was challenged about the situation in local authorities and how very often it's Labour-led local authorities and Labour-controlled local authorities that are doing the Tories' dirty work for them, imposing these cuts on disabled people, again, they wouldn't commit to any sorts of opposition. And so, and that's the real crux of this matter, that it's local authorities up and down the country, no matter what. And they say they respect the rule of law. And we often hear this about the rule of law. But which law do they obey? Do they obey austerity law that's closed the independent living fund, that has forced independent living fund users into this barbaric, oppressive local authority system to have their budgets slashed and all of the things that you've heard today? Or do they obey the Care Act, which is also law? Well, they've chosen to obey austerity law, not the law that protects disabled people. Mm. And that's the crucial one. This is a human rights struggle of the highest order. And let's be clear, they're breaking not just domestic law, they're breaking Article 8 of the European Convention on Human Rights, and they're breaking Article 19 of the Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities that the government has signed and ratified. So this is a huge struggle that we're in. Equalise is continuing this. What's interesting, out of the publicity that we got, we were getting nowhere until Community Care picked it up and until The Guardian picked it up. And then suddenly things started to happen. And I suppose lessons for other disabled people's organisations is that virtually all of the people who were disabled people, whose cases were put forward under our original action, have had their cases reviewed and resolved, and they've either been, if they've lost services completely, they've been brought back into services, or they've had their budgets lifted. We've now had one case that we were very close to taking to judicial review, and the council buckled right at the last minute. We've still got a whole number of, and that person has had her budget restored to where it was, and some people have actually had them increased. There's two people that still are outstanding from the original lot. But of course, we've still got an avalanche of people coming through who are having their budgets destroyed and being illegally assessed and illegally pushed through. So we're still working with solicitors to try and get a judicial review, because that's what's needed. So the conclusions are that this isn't just the Norfolk issue, this is a nationwide issue. That we don't believe any council, apart from maybe Hammersmith and Fulham, although I suspect there's lots of smoke and mirrors there as well, is compliant with the Care Act. So what actions are we continuing with? Well, we're carrying on with the legal route and helping and supporting disabled people to put them in touch with solicitors to take that through. We're also trying to launch a national social care crisis lived experience website, a whistleblower's website, if you like, where we're constructing at the moment a website where people, wherever they are in the country, can go on to the and put their experience of social care cuts, ILF users, other people who are eligible. And we're trying to create it so that we can create, through the website, reports that can go into not just give us a national picture, but can also give us local pictures. So they can be used by local DPOs as campaigning tools to challenge their local authorities. And we're going to work with DPAC from their postcode lottery research and try and put those two things together so that we can actually expose and blow this crisis apart. Because we can't wait till 2020. This crisis is happening today. People are prisoners in their own homes today. People are being taken things away and all the distressing stories we've heard. So this is a very real fight that we need to take back to all our local authorities and all our, and I think, you know, that's the one contribution that we can make. The other thing I would appeal to people is, if you're not members of the Reclaiming Our Futures Alliance, which is the new national body of disabled people's user-led organisations, join today. It's free for individuals, it's free for small DPOs that don't have any resources, and then there's a sliding scale of membership to give us some resources for the DPOs that do have a bit more money. But we need a national voice alongside DPAC that can really coordinate these campaigns and really push this out there. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Mark. Now, I understand our friend Nick Dayton MP has had to leave, but are there any other Labour MPs present that would like to say anything?
Or any other party?
Or any other party?
My name's Ian Lucas, I'm the Labour MP for Wrexham, and which is in Wales, so there's a different situation again. Nathan, who's sitting in front of me, told me about the meeting, and I'm very pleased to be here today. But we've got a, obviously there's a different situation again in Wales, because just for information, the budget has been devolved to the Welsh Government, who I think in the process of carrying out a consultation at the moment on that as an issue. But it's been very interesting to hear you. Actually, very moving. I came along earlier, I had to go and ask a question in the chamber, and I've come back again. So I've heard some of the presentations, but not all of them. But I think that what's really important is that you communicate with your members of parliament. And I appeal to you individually to go to see them. Don't send them an email, go and see them. And tell them about your own personal experience. And Nathan and I don't agree on everything, but he's a very powerful advocate. And coming along here today has redoubled my mind in arguing the case for the disabled constituents. And you need to make that case to whoever is representing you. And it doesn't matter what party they're in, that individual should be put under pressure, because it's just coming into the room is very powerful. Hearing the testimony from people is very powerful too. We've got such a powerful case. And there are also people who don't receive any money from the Independent Living Fund because the fund was closed, who should be receiving it. And I think the argument about, you know, about developing the potential of disabled people to do things in their lives that will benefit everybody in society is really important. And I think you've got to make that argument to your Member of Parliament personally and keep the pressure up on your MPs. That's what I'll be saying.
Yeah.
I just wanted to say in response to that you know, we have for years just been drawing all of these issues that have been outlined today to the to our local MPs. So I think it's just not enough for Labour politicians to keep coming to meetings and saying that, because we've done that time and time again with all of our MPs, including our Labour MPs, and there is no decisive, constructive decisions or action taken by the Labour Party or most political parties to take these issues forward and do some work, instruct local Labour councils to do something positive. And it's not enough to just keep coming to meetings with disabled people and just keep telling us to keep raising the issues. We're sick of it.
You have to understand, in the first instance, that those Labour people who are in positions of power have actually hugely diminished budgets and have difficult decisions to make in those budgets.
Sent back money to the DWP. They sent £100,000 back
in
unspent discretionary housing payments, which meant that disabled people were not getting help with bedroom tax.
As Camden Council.
The people who support Owen Smith, I mean, Jeremy Corbyn and John McDonnell have been supporting the Save the ILF funds.
John's actually just joined us to actually say a few words if you don't mind, John.
Hey.
It's good to see you. It's good to see you when we're not storming the doors of Parliament. Not yet, someone said. Let me just be clear what we're doing. This week of action by DPAC, which includes this, has a range of other actions as well that are taking place to highlight the plight of people with disabilities, disabled people. And it's important that we try and get across the message, I think, to the wider public and to individual MPs through all these actions now, just the impact of the last, 7 to 8 years, really, in terms of following the crash. Some of you will remember, I think it's now 4 years ago, I'm losing track of time as I get older, sorry. I think it's 4 years ago now, we did the WOW petition to try and establish a cumulative impact assessment of all the changes. Now we, if you can remember then in that debate, what we said was it would be relatively easy for the government to look at each individual decision, their consequences, and then cumulatively add those consequences up, not just in terms of lost money, but also in terms of, to be frank, the human suffering that's gone on. And one of the ones we were campaigning on at that point in time was the WCA and its implications. And we said then that that would lead to not just the withdrawal of funds, the human suffering, it would lead to loss of life. And to be frank, all the evidence now has proved us to be exactly right in terms of the number of people that have, well, lost their lives as a result of that. Well, abuse really, because you couldn't see, call anything else in terms of the implementation of the WCA. Some of those loss of lives was as a result of literally people not being able to care for themselves or even fund basic living standards, even food at one point in time. If you remember, in David Cameron's own constituency, we had someone who literally starved to death, and we highlight that in our campaign. But in addition to that, we highlighted that as well as the depth of suffering, it was the withdrawal of ILF in particular that was forcing people either back into their homes so that they could no longer live a life that others live, basically, so they could no longer integrate into society. But in addition to that, it was forcing people into residential establishments where there was no need to, and certainly wasn't their choice. And a lot of what we predicted there then is actually coming true now as a result of loss of grant, and as a result of the failure to legally protect that grant when it's transferred to local authorities. Now, the question that I came in on was about local authorities and their decision making. The decision making that's made by local government, to be frank, we no longer have areas of local democracy in this country because so much is determined centrally by central government. And we need to make that clear to people as well, that what central government is doing by the withdrawal of grant or the refusal to legislate to ensure that it's protected is actually forcing local councils themselves into these cuts too. Now what we want to do is work with those local authorities to ensure that the services are protected as best they can, but also we want them campaigning alongside us to force government policy to change as well. And that's the attitude we've taken all the way along. And some local authorities are doing that, others aren't. And one of the whole point about this report and its recommendations is that it's trying to find, first of all, the evaluation of this particular impact of this particular decision by government, and try and get objective facts about that out there. And it's unchallengeable, to be frank, the work that's been done, it's unchallengeable. But also in the recommendations to then look for a way forward. And I support the recommendations. And the way forward is to try and work together in that respect. So just on behalf of Jeremy Corbyn, myself and others in the party, what we want to do is use this here to highlight the problems of withdrawal of ILF and the impact it's had, everything that we predicted. Work with local authorities as well to say, look, we'll support you when you stand up against central government as well about the decisions that they're making, their impact on people with disabilities and disabled people. But in addition to that, to start working now, to be frank, because I don't know how long this government is going to survive, start working now on what we want to do when we go back into government and as a Labour Party. These recommendations in here give us the basis of that, the policy that we can try and implement. Finally, let me just say this. There are a number of other actions that will be taken by DPAC, the Black Triangle, and others over this next week, because this is the week of the Paralympics. And we all support the Paralympics. It's a fantastic opportunity of people participating, demonstrating their sporting skills, etc. And there'll be lots about it in the media. But the two things I find angry-making, really, is just how the difficulty we've had in recent years about getting the media to focus on the impact of the cuts that have taken place. And ILF is one of those. That's why we've had to take direct action time and time again to get that publicity. But the others as well, the sheer hypocrisy of politicians and, to be frank, government politicians and others, about how they celebrate the Paralympics while at the same time they're taking decisions to cut benefits to people who actually will be forced back into their home, into residential establishments, and in some instances, not survive. That's why all our campaigning now, as has been done this week and will be continuing on, and certainly from the Labour Party's perspective, will be with you on this. All our campaigning will be to highlight that basic hypocrisy at the heart of government policy making now and over the last 7 years as well. We cannot stand by while fellow citizens have their lives put at risk or go through such human suffering, or in some instances degradation as well, as a result of this inhuman policy that's been implemented over the last 7 years. So I'm here really, apart from performing my most important role, which is booking the room. thanks for that. I'm glad to make some contribution. I'm here just as an act of solidarity as well. Thanks a lot.
Yeah.
Before you go, I'm Jonathan Barley from the Green Party. There are, one of the things that's come up maybe while you weren't here was the concern that there are Labour-run councils that aren't ring-fencing the money, and this is one of the recommendations that you support. There is money there. It's the former ILF recipient grant, so we know the money's there. The problem is that they're not ring-fencing it. So would you write to Labour-run councils and urge them, as Shadow Chancellor, to do that?
We'll do that.
Thank you.
But we'll be talking to individual councils, as we have done over the last 10 months or so, about how they can protect the funding here. We know the pressure they're under. I was a Labour councillor years ago on the GRC. I wouldn't want to be in local government at the moment. And it's an unthankful task, being in whatever political party you're in terms of being a local authority councillor at the moment, because of the pressure that you're under. But we want to work with them to protect these funds. But also, just as importantly, we want to work with them to expose what central government is doing. Because I think if we can build the momentum of this campaign beyond just ourselves, deep into the heart of local authorities, and we have what we had a number of years ago, a number of local authorities along with us on demonstrations and direct actions, highlighting, doing their own individual reports, the consequences in their communities, I think that will build up such pressure on central government we can push them back. And remember, over the last year, even in Parliament where they've got a majority, we've used parliamentary debates, amendments in Parliament, then working with the House of Lords as well, although I've been trying to abolish them for the last 30 years, working with them, we've been able to defeat them on a number of things, like tax credits and like PIP. So this is one of those areas as well, I think, that we can push back and win on.
The mindset of, there was one mentioned in Norfolk somewhere, their mindset is, it's not our responsibility to pay for the social lives of disabled people. They kind of see it as a kind of a luxury that they don't particularly want to support.
But what's interesting, you know as well as I do, what's interesting is as the cuts are impacting via local authorities, more and more people are turning up and being dependent on the health service. So what you're getting now is withdrawal of care or not a standard of care that we would have expected, and people are turning up with A&E. And then what happens is, if they get admitted, they then get accused of bed blocking. And then they do get out, their only option then is, because of the lack of support or withdraw the support, is then into residential care. Yeah. And it's a vicious circle that people have gone down. Yeah. As individual MPs, we're all dealing with these cases as well.
Yeah. Can I just ask, from the timeline on when you will write to the Labour authorities to ring fence it? Because like in Manchester, there's no care outside the house.
Yeah, yeah.
It is changing now because we've got people who aren't going to survive.
Yeah, okay. We'll do it now.
Thank you. Right.
Thank you. Alan.
Right.
Time-wise, can I run over a little bit? I know you want...
Well, don't split the room, I think.
Okay. Yeah. I'd like to take ask a few former ILF recipients just to make a few brief comments. Is Mark Williams...
Yeah.
Hi, Mark.
Hello,
everyone. Is it possible when people can to go to the front? Because what we want is to capture it on the film with the interpreter behind to make it accessible to ASL users watching the film. Is that all right, Mark?
How long do you want us to talk? Very briefly, if possible.
No,
I'm sorry. We're going to go try and do a photo op before we finish as well, which would be quite useful.
Yes.
Sorry, we're at most. We need to crack down.
Oh.
So, in Bristol, where I'm from, we are very fortunate at the moment. I'll do a lot of cuts out BD. And all of they ring fence the money to health and social care only. They are, at the moment, they are. Is it 100 people? What if 100 people in Bristol are still getting their funding, as far as you know, in America? But at the moment, I'd like to put another elephant in the ring. We are, obviously, many of us are actually breaking the law under employment laws after the living wage has come changed. So, a lot of us were paying a set rate for overnight care and it, and along with all the other money that we're paying our staff, we're actually paying below the either the living wage or the national minimum wage. And so our local affairs is, first of all, A, they're not telling people about it, and B, they're obviously not putting the funding up to cover it. So, we are in the wrong. So we have to keep fighting for our rights. Okay?
Man. Condition leaves susceptible to infections and have terrible skin problems as well. So leaving me in soiled nappies for up to 12 hours at a time would be putting my health at risk and would leave with more hospitalizations and would cost the country more in the end. Not just me and my life and my health, it would cost the country more. But it's not social services budget, so we don't care. Thanks to Inclusion London and an incredibly wonderful solicitor, I've been fighting the council and they've increased their offer of care, but they now still want to cut my hair by 46 hours a week. died as well, but social services just wanted to have my career before really made meals. And I said, I can't even afford these by being able to have locally produced food and food from small stores rather than big stores. And I'm able to keep my budget really low, but still have really healthy, active diets. But again, they're not interested, so I'm having to fight them. I asked my MP, Ruth Cadbury, Labour MP, to help to fight this for me. She wrote to the council and they said, oh no, we're actually offering her an increase in care, not a decrease, not a cut. It's not a cut. Because initially they were giving me 35 hours, and at the point when she wrote, they were offering me 36 hours. So one additional hour, 1 hour of my ILF care, and they were counting that as an increase. So the councils are being deliberately denying, basically, and they're trying to make people feel that they are doing something good and sometimes increasing, when actually they're making massive cuts. And I'm not the only ILF user in the borough. I don't know how to access and find the rest of the ILF users. From the report that was sent to Ruth Cadbury following her initial inquiry, when she was told that I'm getting an increase, she asked for a breakdown of the numbers, and some of them have got no care whatsoever. Some of them have got a decrease in care, some have got the same care, and by that I presume they're getting the same as direct PIMS care, none of the ILF care. And some have had an increase, and by that I presume that means, like me, they're in one or two hours of the ILF care that they were working. So we need to understand that the cuts are impacting on many people that we aren't even aware of, we can't even find to be able to support. And we need to find ways of being able to do that. My council, when I said to them that the new care hours they're prescribing are just insufficient, they said that they will send a team of people to actually observe how that care is implemented. In other words, they want to see everything that care is providing you with. So they want to be able to see how I go to the toilet, how I'm showered, how I get out of bed, how I'm put into bed, how I'm fed. And it's this that has really broken me. I just can't bear the thought of having a team of people invade my home and my precinct, come into my toilets, into my bedroom, into my shower. It was bad enough when they suggested that I use nappies in front of this house to feel so violated in the name of saving my every single person in this country to please stand up and stop this.
Thank you, Mary Ellen. I think we've got time for two final speakers. Is that Nathan behind Mary Ellen? Yeah. Nathan. Make it brief. So behind Mary Ellen is Nathan. Just get the interpreter get next to Nathan.
Just speak for me.
Oh, yeah, we'll just get the interpreter to stand next to you, if that's okay, Nathan.
My situation is slightly different because I live in North Wales. So, thankfully, I've had a children's age. I think you can believe that. But I've had a children's age that the ILF which is now called the West End Bend Living Ground, will be there until 2020. But, you know, I'm still campaigning because God knows what's going to happen after that. And, you know, I still worry about disabled people as a whole, whether they live in England or Wales or wherever they live. So I feel like I've got to use my time until 2020 to campaign for everyone, wherever they live, wherever continent. Like I say, I've been a child care last of the Western Bedlam Grant till 2020, but the actual hours I receive are not good enough for my care needs. I've got progressive disability, so when I first started using the ILF, I had 86.5 hours a week, and that used to be okay. People would come in and get me up and stay with me till 2 o'clock in the afternoon, and then come back at 7 o'clock at night. So I was okay. I used to be okay on my own for those four hours in the middle of the day, but now you know, it's quite embarrassing. I have to when people leave at 2 o'clock, and they have to undo my trousers so I can use my urinal. But then if anyone comes and knocks on my door between 2 and 7, then I've got my jeans undone, so I haven't really got any dignity. So I have to just pull my t-shirt down as far as I can and then answer the door. But it's not ideal. And then, like, maybe one day, maybe 2:30 or something, I might spill, drop the contents of my urine on my jeans. So I have to sit like that until 7 o'clock, and little things are not good. But it's just no one will listen to us. Like my MP said, speak to your MP, which I've been doing for like 6 years, but you know, we still in this situation of desperation, and it's difficult to know which way to think, who's gonna help us, you know. Just gotta keep fighting and keep believing that maybe one day we'll be lucky to have Jeremy Corbyn, John McDonnell. Maybe we can hope you'll win power. Win power and start to represent our views. Because we're all like human beings, same as anyone else. and hopefully one day that'll be realised. And I've got loads more to say. I'm going on land train, I think. Oh, I wish I'd said that, I wish I'd said this. But you're all probably thinking, okay, well, I don't know. So I better stop and let you all get on with your lives.
Thank you, guys. This is actually part of InclusionLondon.
Took a decision about who will pay for that crash. And it was either the bankers or the financial institutions, or was ordinary working people,
or
disabled people, exactly. And they chose
ordinary people.
Exactly. And so they then introduced austerity measures, a whole range of cuts across all benefits, but they targeted, I think they targeted disabled people because they thought that disabled people were the ones that would not fight back. And although we've done everything we can in Parliament to oppose that, publicise what's going on, the most effective action of opposition has been by organisations like DPAC and Black Triangle, Inclusion London and others like yourselves to expose what's been going on. And that's what we've got to continue to do. And in some instances, take the WCA administration under ATOS, for example, the direct action that we took was successful. ATOS had to give up the contract. Maximus took it over, and now we're campaigning against them. And we've forced them back each time. The government wanted to come in with further cuts to PIP, and we've pushed them back. So what we have to do, you ask the question why, that's the reason they decided of disabled people would pay for these drug prices. Mm. And what we've got to continue to do is exactly as you're doing today, which is to continue to campaign against that, expose what's going on, and force this government back. But, you know, there's a number of us here from different political parties, and our solution is to get rid of this government and replace it with one that has a respect for humanity, and that will protect the ILF, and will introduce a proper system for supporting people with disabilities, disabled people, so that they can live full and enjoyable and happy lives integrated within society. And that's what we're about.
A very brief question.
Yes. I was the one. I was the monster to change. Is it as of this?
Sorry, I'm struggling to just cast it. We have to do it every 4 years.
Do we have to do this every 4 years?
No, yes, it's 20 years.
Is that
27?
Because the ILF is supposed to be.
It's 2070.
Yeah.
Okay. I think if we can build the movement in this country that we started at that first DPAC conference only 5 or 6 years ago, if we can build the disabled movement in the same way as has happened elsewhere, I think we'll build the strength amongst ourselves, linked up with others, linked with progressive political parties, and linked with the trade union movement and other progressive groups. I think if we can build that strength, will ensure that strength ensures that no politician dare ever come again to cut the benefits for people with disabilities, disabled people. It needs us to continue to mobilise and build the mobilisation on a scale that we haven't seen before. But that's happening. Everywhere I go now, disabled people are demonstrating, taking direct action, exposing what's going on, explaining.
I'm going to have to stop you there because we need to have one more speaker. I want to invite Mitchell Wolfe from Scott Monkley Solicitors, who's done an amazing amount of work behind the scenes. I'd just like to Mitchell say a few words, if that's okay, before we end.
Well, thank you very much. I will be very brief, but obviously I think the testimonies of what people have said there is far, far more powerful than anything I can say. What I can say is that with the ending of the ILF, and it came in at the same time as the entry of the Care Act 2014, despite the rhetoric that was around at the time, what I've witnessed from the work I've done is, well, I'll tell you that councils don't read ILF assessments, they don't know or care how people used their ILF monies, what good they did. I constantly see a lack of transparency, a failure to provide information, a failure to provide anything in writing so that anything's directly challengeable. There is a constant failure to engage with disabled people and their carers, and that failing to work with people means that they don't involve them in decisions. They produce plans without speaking with people and finding out whether these plans are actually realistic or not. And when packages are cut, often people aren't given the reasons why those packages are cut. One thing I would like to say, and I think this probably epitomises some of what I've seen, is I just want to refer to a letter that was sent round to a number of people who were former ILF users who had their packages cut. And it was a round robin general letter that said, "We have now reassessed your needs following the end of the ILF. Someone will be coming." That was the first paragraph. The second paragraph said, "Someone will be coming to visit you in the next few weeks to put together a care plan." The third paragraph said, "We have now cut your package, and your package cut will be cut within 20 days. Within one letter, they managed to somehow, miraculously, do the assessment care planning process. It's outrageous, isn't it? And it's unlawful. And unfortunately, you know, as lawyers, we scratch the surface because we know there are so many other people out there. But the cut to ILF is taking us backwards. Mm. And it's the antithesis of what the ILF set out to achieve, to get people to be supported, to live independently, to have autonomy, to be able to work and to access the community. And it's so short-sighted because it doesn't recognise, by failing to provide these important provisions, What we do is put people into crisis and we bring about greater need for health services. And in a survey last year, 99% of NHS managers said that the cuts in social care resulted in far more work and pressure on health. These cuts represent a false economy. But I do have to say that with reports like this and with the voices that we've heard today and hopefully we'll keep on hearing, these are the things that we can use to challenge this, because the fight really must go on. Thank you.
It's a really small gesture, but I'm going to cry again. Everyone here has made a massive contribution to the ILF campaign and supporting each other, but I hope people don't mind me picking out Mitchell individually, because Mitchell has given so much support to so many people. When people have had their packages cut, I know I can refer them to Mitchell, and Mitchell will work really, really hard for them and really understand the law really well. So this is from all of the people that I've referred to you over the last
Thank you so much.
One very brief last comment, and then I'm going to have to wrap up.
Just to say that the fight against being forced to use incontinence pads, the case of Elaine McDonald that went to the Supreme Court was a very important time that we lost. You know, various of us got together to support Elaine McDonald, who was a pensioner who lost her overnight sitter and was forced to accept incontinence pads by the Supreme Court, and the only judge to dissent from that was Lady Hale, who has also opposed the total benefit cap and other things. And, you know, just to say that there's at least a million pensioners who are without home care, and a lot of the deaths from cold during the winter is because no one is going to people's homes to even visit them. And, you know, so I think the thing of the ILF being of the standard for everybody is really important, you know, that we're all entitled to it, and Trident and everything else can pay for it in 2 seconds.
Okay, I'd like to thank everyone for coming today, for all the speakers. I think we've got a way forward, that we keep on fighting, that we campaign, we lobby our MPs, we lobby our local authorities, we join together with other disabled people, and we continue fighting. There's activities going on throughout this week, supported by DPAC and other organisations, Rights Not Gays, so on social media, you can use that hashtag and join and support the various events that are going on this week, and thank you for coming. Safe journey home. Mm-hmm.
Okay, thank you so much for being with us. And yeah, thank you so much, you can watch for posting the one about the Inclusion London. By the way, if you guys are interested in the report, it's actually on the Inclusion London website. And this is called 1 Year On, Impact of the Evaluating the Impact of the Closure of the Independent Living Fund. So you would be able to find that on their Inclusion London website. So yeah, okay, anyway, hope to come back to you soon, but we'll see. Anyway, peace out guys, and I shall speak to you later. Thank you, bye.